I'm speaking quickly on the subject tonight, together for good. Together for good. Romans chapter 8, verse 28 said, "And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose." And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. We serve a God who is a specialist in bringing good out of bad or evil. He's the God who specializes in bringing the best out of the worst. The God who specializes in bringing full sense out of nonsense. He is the God who specializes in bringing meaningfulness out of meaninglessness. You find yourself in a situation and you are saying, what kind of meaningless, aimless situation is this? We serve that God. That is why our subject tonight is together for good. That there is a synergy of energy in the situations of our lives that will produce the best of destiny. I'll give you a few examples. Joseph was called the dreamer, who was hated and envied because of his dreams. Because of his dreams, his brethren sold him into slavery. The young man was 17 years old when he was abruptly disconnected from being a full-blooded Israelite to becoming an Egyptian slave for 13 solid years. The outcome of it is well known to every one of us. He became the prime minister of Egypt, the second most important person. Actually, he was the de facto president of Egypt. Pharaoh was just figurehead. When his brethren tried to be sorry for what they did to him, Joseph told them, he said to them, "Don't blame yourselves. No need to blame yourselves." That was Genesis chapter 50, verse 19. "No need to blame yourselves. As for you, you meant evil." Don't blame yourselves. I'll read it very, very quickly. Genesis chapter 50. I'll look at that in verse 19. "And Joseph said unto them, Fear not, for am I in the place of God? But as for you, you thought evil against me. But God meant it unto good to bring to pass, as it is this day, to save much people alive. Now, therefore, fear ye not, for I will nourish you and your little ones." And he comforted them and spake kindly unto them. You meant evil. Your plan was evil. What you intend out of this is evil. Just like the situation we find ourselves now. The demon of coronavirus and all the demons behind this agenda, whether there are human conspiracies, whatever it is behind this agenda, has colossal evil in mind concerning the planet Earth. Economies of nations crumbling. And one of the major targets is the Church of Jesus Christ, the body of Christ. Because by the time the churches and places of worship were asked not to open, markets were still open. The first thing that came to the mind of those who will make any decree or anything was church. It didn't start from Nigeria. It started from outside the country and from foreign countries. The country here only followed suit. So that devil that brought the virus in the first place has evil in mind for the economies of nations, evil in mind for the lives of people. We are seeing people die like flies in many countries. Evil in mind for the worship of Jehovah, because the devil fears the synergy of the energy of the brethren. But I have good news for you. What the devil planned for evil is coming out in a very, very fearful and frightening way, until the devil will regret his devilishness in this particular situation. That was Joseph. The brethren meant evil. The virus means evil. The conspiracies and the conspirators and anything behind this virus all meant evil. But we serve a God who is a specialist in bringing good out of bad, full sense out of nonsense, meaningfulness out of meaninglessness. You see the example again, number two, of a man called Obed-Edom the Gittite. David, the king of Israel, when he became king, determined that they will bring the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord back to where it belonged, from the land of the Philistines. And David, and then they organized for an ox cart that carried the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord and literally put the glory of God on animals. And that was contrary to the due order, because there was an order set in Scripture that only the Levites should carry the ark. Only the Levites. But they put it on an ox-driven cart, and it was driven by Uzzah and Ahio. While they were in the process, there was a gallop somewhere, and the ark stumbled, and Uzzah tried to hold the ark as if a man wanted to support God. And the anger of the Lord rushed at Uzzah, and Uzzah died on the spot. In 2 Samuel chapter 6 verse 9. And David was afraid of the Lord that day, and said, "How shall the ark of the Lord come to me?" So David will not remove the ark of the Lord unto him into the city of David, but carried it aside into the house of Obed-Edom the Gittite. That is, this thing that is killing people, I can't bring it to my house, and I can't take it to the house of anybody who is valuable. There is a Gittite here, a Gittite. That one, if he dies, no challenge. And they put the ark in his house. And the ark of the Lord continued in the house of Obed-Edom the Gittite 3 months. And the Lord blessed The Lord bless you. I thought they said Obed-Edom the Gittite will die. The Lord bless Obed-Edom the Gittite and all his household. And it was told King David, saying, "The Lord has blessed the house of Obed-Edom and all that pertaineth unto him because of the ark of God." So David went and brought up the ark of God from the house of Obed-Edom into the city of David with gladness. It was meant to kill him. It made him live. It caused him to blossom. It caused him to flourish, until he became the envy of his generation, until the whole king of the land envied him. Whatever the devil has planned to kill you and your family, I declare it is turning out for your good. In the name of Jesus, this evil that the devil has prognosticated and forecasted disaster for Africa, it is turning around for our good. This evil that the devil has thought is going to be the end of the body of Christ in the world, we declare to the devil, get ready. You are about to see the greatest revival you have never seen before. You are about to see the greatest devastation to the kingdom of darkness since your history as a devil. Hallelujah. We are getting better. That was Obed-Edom the Gittite. And of course, you remember the final example I'll give today is the crucifixion of our Lord Jesus Christ. They say, nail him, kill him, crucify him. He's this, he's that. is a criminal. He is a this. He is a that. And when they were crucifying him, they were very happy. The devils were gathered together. And they say, has he died? And sure, he has thoroughly died. And then he died. Have you buried him? And sure, you buried him very well. Then they buried him. Are you sure he's well buried? Yes. All right. Let us pay some people, if you read the Matthew's version, so that they can watch the grave. Because the deceiver said, after 3 days, he will rise from the dead. Let some people keep the grave in case his disciples come and steal him in the night. And they said, he has risen from the dead. They did all that. But on the Sunday morning, he rose from the dead. Have you ever seen a man who rose from the dead like Jesus Christ? Whenever you see me, I talk about Jesus. He's the owner of my soul. Anywhere you see me, I talk about Jesus. He's the owner of my soul. He's the owner. He's the owner. He's the owner of my life. He's the owner. He's the owner. He's the owner of my life. Suddenly, something began to happen in the grave. And they are asking, what happened? He's resurrecting. The demons are scattering and scampering in fear, in dread. And the worst damage Satan experienced since his satanism, since his devilism, the most colossal damage happened as Jesus was resurrecting, as he crushed the head of Satan in fulfillment of the prophecy where he said, the seed of the woman shall bruise your head. You shall only bruise his heel. As Jesus stood on the head of Satan in the grave that day before his resurrection, and he said, surrender back the authority that Adam gave to you. And he collected the keys of hell and death and received the authority back in favor of humanity. No wonder the Bible says, we speak a wisdom. In 1 Corinthians chapter 2, I will start reading from probably verse 7. He said, let's look at this. He said, from verse 6, he said, how be it we speak wisdom among them that are perfect, yet not the wisdom of this world, nor of the princes of this world that come to naught. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory, which none of the princes of this world knew. For had they known, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. That is literally what was happening in their camp. Had we known. You know, had I known is a language of regret. It's a language of loss, regretful loss. Had they known, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. The devil is about to do, had I known, concerning your life, concerning your family, concerning your destiny, concerning our nation, concerning the body of Christ in the world. Had we known. Because something is about to happen. Something is about to happen. That was Joseph's brethren sold him. Obed-Edom the Gittite, our master Jesus Christ. You saw Job. Entered into the furnace of affliction. And he came out to the pain and shame of the devil far better than how he entered. You saw Daniel. Enter the lion's den. And Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. There was no loss. I prophesy to your life, to your family, and to our nation. There shall be no loss. I prophesy to the church, the body of Christ in this season. There shall be no loss. in the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. If it is working together for good, what is going to be the good that we expect? Number one is spiritual toughness. Spiritual toughness, spiritual resilience. There are many children of God in this season that are going to come out in absolute radicalism, absolute ruggedization. That devil is in trouble. You know that the charcoal, after it had been put under pressure, intense pressure, for a very long time, brittle, fickle, breakable charcoal, black, ugly, gets transformed into hard rock, mud and rock solid diamond. Probably the strongest and then the most precious, most valuable of all precious materials to ever exist. It came out of pressure. Spiritual toughness. Spiritual resilience. What has happened has only radicalized people, has only ruggedized people. That was the kind of radicalization Job experienced in that season, where he said, Satan, listen to me. Even though he slay me, I will serve him. I will follow him. Listen to me, Satan. I'm not giving up. I'm not giving way. I'm not giving in. I'm not giving out. I am not giving in. If a man dies, shall he live again? All the days of my appointed time, I will wait until my change comes. There is a set of end time rugged soldiers that are coming out of this season. How many of you know that you never knew how valuable service was until this season? We took it for granted. You see, the praise worship session, the exciting testimony sessions, the interjections of the pastors coming in and saying this and that, and all the exciting things and the songs and the worship and the preaching and the freedom and the testimonies and all that. We didn't know how valuable. You didn't know how valuable. We knew that it was good to worship together and fellowship, but the extent of his value just dawned on many of us right now. The pastor was always there. And now you're only watching via television. Your brother, your sister was always sitting near you. I believe now that after this season is over, quarrel over seat will be reducing. I think quarreling over who this is my seat or that is your seat or I came here first. I think it will reduce because nobody is quarreling over seat now, where you are now. Wherever you are sitting now, it's okay for you. Are you hearing what I'm saying here? But there is an absolute ruggedization, a radicalization, where people are going to be madder with Jesus. Madder in love. Let the devil and his agents get ready. Those who were happy and rejoicing that there is no church holding, let them get ready with them. They are going to see a crop of crazy people for Jesus that will depopulate hell and populate heaven in this season like they have never seen before. That is part of what this is producing. Ruggedity, ferocity, thunderosity, rascality, radicality for God. Spiritual toughness is coming out of this. So much so that the devil will regret why he caused this to the world. Then number two is the knowledge of the other side of God. There is a side of God. There was a side of God Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego did not know until they entered inside fire. That is not a side of God that could have been preached by a sermon, that could have been taught. It was a side of God that was only understandable inside the fire. Because they realized that they were bound. And as they were throwing them in the fire, those who were throwing them in the fire died. That was a dimension they never knew before. Those who were trying to throw them into the fire were burnt by fire and died. As they stepped into the fire, the chains on their feet melted. Before they could say, praise the Lord, a fourth man appeared, which was the Son of God. The fourth man does not appear outside the fire. The fourth man does not appear at the edge of the fire. The fourth man appears in the middle of the fire. And he appeared. And they experienced him like they have never known before. That was a side of God they would never have known except they were inside fire. Daniel knew a side of God he never would have known before until he was inside the lion's den. My God has sent his angels and shut the mouths of the lions. He wouldn't have known that that was a possibility. Which means he fellowshiped with the angel overnight inside the den of the lion. Job knew the side of God he never knew before inside his affliction. Listen, beloved, don't let this season pass just like that. Lord, show me the side of you that I have not known yet in this season. That is your prayer. No wonder Paul the Apostle prayed and said that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering, being made conformable unto his death. Lord, show me the side of you I don't know yet. And he's going to show you. Maybe it is going to be the supply area. The El Shaddai-ness of God. The Obadabada-ness of God. The Jireh-ness of God. Supernatural provider. Divine supplier. Running out of resources. And all of a sudden somebody calls you up. Wire something. I mean, just another side of God. Lord, don't let this day, this season pass. Because it's passing very shortly. Until I see another side of you. Number three is the opportunity to reflect and to strengthen what really matters to life. This is the season where you reflect in order to strengthen what really matters to life. For example, family relationship. There are many people married to wives that they don't know. There are many married to husbands that they don't know. You said to me, Pastor, why, what are you talking about? Do you remember that Jacob was with Rachel one full night? Sorry, was with Leah and thought he was with Rachel. Overnight, after he labored for 7 years for Rachel, they packaged Leah and gave Leah to him. And he was with Leah overnight and thought he was with Rachel. It was in the morning he realized, this is not the woman I labored for. Wow. How can somebody be with his equerry wife one whole night and you are not aware that that is not the woman you went to marry? Even if they were identical twins. That is the kind of indictment that many men have today. Do you know your wife? Do you really know your wife? Do you know who you are married to? Do you know her? I told a story some time ago, which I think I read somewhere. A woman with her husband grew together, made money together. Suddenly, the man began to have relationship with his secretary. And the secretary put the man under pressure that for their relationship to be successful, the man must divorce his wife and marry her. The woman did everything to please the man. The man said no. The woman did everything. The man said, please, I want to divorce you. Everything I have, take anything you want out of it. Take anything you want from them and you can go so that I can marry this other woman. The woman did everything, no way. So she calmed down and said, you know what? I don't want anything from you. You know the way you carried me on our wedding day? Carry me like that for 30 days. After 30 days, you have carried me like that for 30 days. After 30 days, you can go ahead and divorce me and marry who you want. Oh, the man said, that is very easy. I carry you in my hand for 30 days and that will make me to divorce you. Oh, why not? And he carried her in the hand. Their child, a son, one child. The first day he saw the father carried a mother, he was jumping and, oh, daddy loves mommy, and so on. But the woman knew what she was doing. He carried her, but the first day the man carried her, he noticed that she was so weightless. And he carried her. By the time it was middle, like day 10, day 12, 13, 14, 15, the bond began to return. By day 30, they have been reunited together. When the man went to tell the Jezebel in the office, I am going back to my wife, that one gave him a dirty slap. But this is the story. The woman made the man carry her so that their bond can be reunited before she died because she had a terminal disease. And she had this disease without the man knowing, and the man was in another relationship that disconnected him from his wife. And this woman did not want to die holding bitterness against this man or to die with the man and her in separation. When the man eventually realized what his wife was passing through under his nose, and he wasn't aware because of a strange woman, he almost wept his eyes and his life out. How callous could he be, living with a woman who was dying under his nose and he was not aware? That will never be your portion. But this is the time to know who you are married to. Know your wife. Know your husband. Know your children. Do you know in Lagos in those days, because of the holdup in Lagos, parents have to wake up around 4 a.m. and to move from somewhere like Ianokpaja side all the way to VI and so on, and to be able to cross all the holdups, they have to come start like 4, 5 a.m. in the morning or 5 a.m. before the children will wake up. They return back after the children have slept. Now, children will grow and they have 10 years, 11, 12 years without really knowing who daddy is. And at the end of the day, you have children living anyhow, doing what they want with their lives. This is the time to know your wife, know your husband, know your children, know your parents. Take the time out. Answer their questions. Interact. Gel. That is why I said, this time is a time that will make the devil regret. This is not a time for the woman to nag You know, I saw a funny sticker, whatever they call it, on the internet the other day, where they wanted to arrest, the police wanted to arrest an old man in Italy on the road, go out when everybody should be indoors. And he said to them that his wife is worse than coronavirus, that instead of staying at home with his wife, he's worse than corona. It's better they arrest him on the street. That is a terrible situation. Terrible situation. No woman must be like that. Neither should any man be like that. Neither should any child be like that. Creating the home a climate of peace and serenity and quietness. Okay? So what are we coming out with? Spiritual toughness, spiritual resilience, spiritual audacity, sagacity, ferocity, where we are going to literally carry church on the head as we value it now. Where we are going to literally run the devil out of town, chase him to hell. The knowledge of the other side of God. That side of God you have not known. And then thirdly, the opportunity to reflect and strengthen what really matters to life. The quality relationships of our lives. Our wives, our husbands, our children. And then number four, is the time to set recovery goals. This is time to set recovery goals. Obviously, during this lockdown or lock-in, there may be things that you should have been doing that can't be done indoors. Maybe things to be done outwards. This is the time to set recovery goals, spiritual recovery goals, and other recovery goals. This is the time to set the goals that will cause you to pursue, overtake, and recover all. That by the time we are out in the next few days, or whatever time, by the time you are out, I will pursue, I will overtake, I will recover all. Recover all. Nothing shall be called a loss. This is the time to set such recovery goals. With a sense of vengeance. When I was in the university, in the medical school, classes would be like from 8 a.m. to 6 p.m. 8 to 12, then 12 to 1 is break, and then 1 again to 6 in the evening, depending on the classes, like 1 to 4, and then the 4 to 6 will be laboratories and other such things. And I determined to pray very well before I go to the classes, between 1 to 3 hours in the morning. Okay? That's between 5 a.m. to 8 a.m. I should have done substantial praying time, and then take another brief time in the break period. Now, every time I maybe overworked and overslept, for example, if I overslept on Thursday, I didn't pray as I should pray, I didn't study the word as I should study on Thursday, by the time Friday arrive, it must pay for it. I will make Friday to pay for Thursday. Do you understand that? I mean, the next day must feel it. The next day, it will be overdrive. It will be overdrive. That was the way it was. I didn't want anything to cheat me in terms of that spiritual schedule. So this is the time to set recovery goals. Recovery goals. By the power of God, by the strength of God, this and that will happen. Like David was told in 1 Samuel chapter 30 and in verse 7 and 8, pursue, overtake, without fail, recover all. Recovery goals. And finally, this is the time to grow in particular areas of grace, in particular areas of desired grace. If there are things you have desired from God, realms of anointings, wisdom, whatever it is, whatever area of thing, maybe power to evangelize or something like that, this is the time to pursue it and desire it. You know, the period for Joseph was a period of very massive development. The period of Joseph in the prison, in Potiphar's house, in prison, let me tell you, first of all, Joseph was able to grow in relationship with God. He grew. Originally, he was only a dreamer. From his father's house, he only dreamt dreams. He didn't tell anybody any interpretation in his father's house. By the time he went to the prison, he had developed not just dreaming now, but interpreting dreams. It was a growth in grace. Now, so he went from revelation to interpretation, and then he grew under Pharaoh to implementation. His administrative managerial prowess developed in Potiphar's house, in the prison. Grace grew. Unction exploded. This is that time. Something you've been trusting God. Ask God practical questions. If I am to evangelize more and win more souls and do that, how do I go about it? If I'm to do this and that, how do I? If I want to hear your voice more clearly, what should I do? And so forth. That is why it is meant to turn out for good. Together for good. Because your spiritual toughness will be confirmed. The knowledge of the other side of God is unveiled to you. Opportunity to reflect and strengthen the things that really matter to life is available to you. Time to set recovery goals so that we can make the devil to pay for anything that appears to have slowed down. Is that time? And of course, time to grow in particular areas of grace. Somebody already blessed, say amen.